Great Scientists and Their Discoveries by David Angus. What is science? Is it, as somebody once said, just measuring things? Well, it certainly involves measuring things. But it would be better to say that science is about describing things, what they are and how they work. What is the point of doing this? It's so that we can learn more about our world and advance our knowledge. And these days, from a scientific point of view, this can only be done with accurate measurements. The proper scientific way of describing things is by putting them together into groups which share the same or similar characteristics. Scientists call this classification, and it was by starting to do this more than 2,000 years ago in ancient Greece that what we now call science actually began. The man who was most responsible for this new and original way of thinking was called Aristotle. Aristotle was fascinated by the natural world, and he spent a lifetime classifying what he saw around him. "It is the nature of man to be curious," he wrote, and certainly he was curious about practically everything. Most importantly, he wrote down his observations so that other people could share them. In his lifetime, he wrote more than 150 books. Aristotle believed that by classifying everything and by identifying each object's or living creature's proper place in the world, we could learn to understand the workings of the whole universe. "Everything in nature," he wrote in his famous book, The Parts of Animals, "contains something of the marvelous." Some of his observations no longer fit with what we know today, but still he made some remarkable discoveries. For example, he observed that dolphins, unlike other fish, give birth to live young, and that the fetus in the womb is fed by the mother thanks to a special organ called the placenta. Aristotle realized this applied to all mammals, but to no other fish, so he decided to class dolphins with the beasts of the field rather than with the fish of the sea. Some sharks also give birth to live young, but since they have no placenta, he classified them as fish. This is the classification that we still use today. Each of Aristotle's books dealt with one of his chosen areas of classification, or subject. Today, when people learn about science, it's usually split into three different subjects: physics, chemistry, and biology. These divisions work well and help science to be more approachable as an area of study, especially at an advanced level. But without Aristotle's conviction that it was important to understand the world in this manner, grouping similar things together, science might never have developed at all, or at least what we call science would have grown up in a very different way.
Galileo Galilei, 1564 to 1642. In 1633, a frail old man named Galileo Galilei stood before the fearsome court of the Inquisition, set up by the Catholic Church in Rome. Galileo, who was 69 years old, had been summoned for the crime of writing a book in which he claimed that the Earth was not, as Aristotle had believed, the centre of the universe. He claimed that he could prove it rotated around the sun. This idea had been declared as heresy, that is to say, it was against the teaching of the Church. If Galileo was found guilty of heresy, he could be burnt at the stake. To satisfy the court, the old man went down on his knees and, with his hand on the Bible, swore that he now believed his scientific theories to be wrong. The Earth stood still at the centre of the universe, he told them. As he rose unsteadily to his feet, he is believed to have whispered under his breath, "And yet it does move." The main theories of Aristotle had remained practically unchallenged for over 2,000 years. In fact, in Europe, so much of what Aristotle had said seemed to fit with the Christian scriptures that over time his ideas had merged in people's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.